Our universe is a fascinating place. It contains galaxies. The galaxies contain stars. Around the stars, there are planets. How did our universe get that interesting? Because it's not always been that way. In the beginning, at the Big Bang, the universe was small, hot, and simple, or to say, boring. In Galaxies and Cosmology, we're trying to figure out how the universe became interesting. And we're doing this in various ways. We are trying to understand what ultimately drives the formation of these beautiful galaxies, the metropolises of our cosmos, where everything happens. And the answer is gravity. But gravity requires dark matter, and we need to understand how this works. So in the end, we'd like to understand all the processes that lead to such beautiful galaxies like our own Milky Way. One centrally important tool is simulations. Over the last decades, we have learned how to simulate a patch of the universe on a computer. And that's important for a number of reasons. First of all, the evolution takes billions of years, and who has that much time? Secondly, it's a combination of dark matter that we cannot see, but only whose gravitational effects we notice, and many other factors. And we have to imagine how else could our universe be. That we can only do on the computer.
Galaxies are the smallest entity that are of cosmological nature. They are the smallest thing that we can think when we think about the universe as a whole. And there are millions and billions of galaxies out there. Based on their properties, on how they're distributed in the sky, or how they evolve in time, we can actually understand how the universe evolves as a whole. Or how the stars move in a galaxy tells us about how gravity works and what kind of matter components are at play. So when we do the simulations, we make assumptions on the laws of physics, the laws of gravity, the matter component of the universe, and then we make predictions on how luminous stars and gas should show up in the observations. By comparing two observations, and assuming that our models are very good, we can then infer back and understand, were the original hypotheses on the nature of dark matter or the evolution of the universe on a large scale correct? Modeling, literally, universes in a box is challenging. In a sense, the blanket is always too short. On the one hand, we always want to model larger and larger cosmological volumes, so to get more and more galaxies or more and more rare objects. On the other hand, we want to model smaller and smaller scales in order to really capture as realistically as possible what happens at the sites of star formation in galaxies.
But of course, we have to ask the universe whether our ideas and theories about it are right. Our theories about how much dark matter and how much of an even more exotic ingredient, dark energy, there is and what it does. To do that, we need to study gravity, and the best way to do this is to watch how mass deflects light. That distorts the images of distant objects. And to do so, for 20 years, we've worked on a space mission that's just been launched named Euclid. It will give us beautiful, high-resolution pictures across much of the sky. Subtle analyses of this mission will eventually tell us what our universe is made of.
The MPIA has been related and involved in Euclid even before it was Euclid, in its predecessor designs and missions, and has then been active and a central part during its design, during its creation of the requirements, science requirements it will have to fulfill during its construction, and now it will be active all the way throughout the survey now that it's in orbit. We have been part of the near-infrared instrument, NISP, the near-infrared spectrometer and photometer, for example, in constructing two parts of hardware, a calibration lamp and the photometry filters. And we are active in the calibration efforts for the whole mission, both preparing before launch, but also throughout the mission to make sure that we're getting the best science data possible. It's a really exciting moment and time now because I've been personally involved in Euclid for more than a decade. I've seen it constructed, designed, changed, passing individual steps in its construction and testing. And then there was this this spacecraft that was suddenly finished. We saw it launch. I saw it launch safely into orbit, big step. And then the first checkout of the instruments showed they all work. We saw the first images coming back. We saw this first light image, and we were totally blown away. I was totally blown away because the data quality, which we had in simulations, yes, but now we saw the real thing. It was an image taken from orbit of the celestial sky, and it was an amazing moment when we saw it works much better even than we expected it to do. And now Euclid is starting its science mission. It's going to observe the sky for at least 6 years. It's going to map more than one third of the whole sky at unprecedented angular resolution and depth. And that's going to be a treasure trove for any astronomer, astrophysicist in the next decades. It's absolutely unprecedented. Whenever someone in the next decades wants to have a high resolution, high definition, high fidelity image of the sky, they can go to the Euclid archives and probably find what they're looking for. This is going to be amazing, an amazing resource and absolutely unprecedented in all different kinds of areas of science or astronomy, from solar system objects that are moving quickly in our vicinity, to faint background in the infrared, to the earliest quasars and galaxies. And of course, for cosmology, we are going to find out much, much more about what this universe contains and how its past and its future are going to be.
In our universe, galaxies are special places. And one of the most remarkable things that became known is that they harbor the centers of galaxies, very massive black holes, billion times more massive than our sun. How do we know this? Black hole you can't see easily, unless stuff falls in and makes it shine very brightly. These objects are called quasars, and we've long at MPIA studied those quasars with the question of how did the black holes get there in the first place. And the way you do this is you look further and further away into the past to ask, are there still black holes or have they not yet formed?
These distant quasars live in galaxies. However, it is extremely hard to study the stellar light coming from these host galaxies, because the central supermassive black hole and the accretion disk is so luminous that it makes it almost impossible at our typical wavelengths. So to do these studies, we go to different telescopes, in particular interferometers in the submillimeter and millimeter wavelengths. For example, the radio telescope ALMA. We are getting data almost every day, and we are really the first generation of human beings able to study these objects with such a powerful machine. I'm sure that in a few years from now, our current understanding will be outdated, and maybe we have to just rewrite the textbooks about the early universe and supermassive black holes.
So the centers of galaxies are extremely interesting. And so one is tempted to look in the best possible detail to see what's going on. Is there a black hole? What are the stars doing? And to do that, you need to have the sharpest image camera ever. And we're part of a team that actually builds for the new giant, extremely large telescope, a camera that will do exactly that.
So I will talk about MICADO. I'm the instrument scientist of MICADO. And MICADO is the first light camera for the biggest telescope we've ever built in for the ground. The 39 meter telescope, actually, the ELT in Chile. So it's important to do that in the near infrared, because the light, when it travels through the universe, is redshifted to the near infrared wavelengths, but also gives us a sharper view, actually, because we are on the ground below the atmosphere, and MICADO deploys a couple of adaptive optic systems which correct the turbulence of the atmosphere to make full benefit of these gigantic 39 meter telescope aperture. And that leads us immediately to the calibration unit we are building here at MPIA, actually, which is now trying to calibrate for instrumental patterns at this precision level we haven't done so before. And one thing we are trying to do is to measure the motion of stars very precisely over several years.
So galaxies consist of billions of stars. In some sense, stars are kind of the elementary particle of the entire cosmos. The question is, where do stars come from? How are they born? They're being born from dense gas that then collapses under its own weight and gravity. But how this process works is actually not well understood. And finally, we have tools to look at the gas that is about to give birth to new stars, or the areas that have just given birth to new stars, to understand how this works in galaxies.
So if we want to understand how stars can form, but also where they can form, we want to study galaxies better, because in galaxies we do see that there is all these different kinds of material, but also structures that can impact the star formation. We need not only one galaxy, but we need a sample of galaxies. And that's why we have the FANG survey, which is a compilation of about 100 galaxies. And those are selected to be part of the so-called main sequence of star-forming galaxies, which just means that we are selecting typical galaxies in the nearby universe. And so we want to have statistical answers on how and where stars form in these galaxies, and therefore we're looking at a sample of typical galaxies.
We have observations by ALMA, observing molecules in those galaxies, observations done with MUSE, observing the stellar distribution, but also we have recent observations with the James Webb telescope, where we can for the first time see the dust in galaxies at a very high resolution that we've never been able to see before with that much detail. One of the first results that we actually see is how newly formed stars actually expand their surroundings and forming huge bubbles in the interstellar medium, which is something that we now for the first time actually could quantify with the James Webb observations.
So for all of our ideas about how galaxies form, the Milky Way is perhaps the ultimate laboratory to figure out whether it works. On the one hand, the Milky Way is a perfectly average galaxy, typical perhaps. On the other hand, we get to see it like no other galaxy in so much detail, star by star, each star we know, its mass, its age, and how it moves, all of which bear witness to our own galaxy's formation.
I am Eleonora Zari. I am a postdoc in the Galaxy and Cosmology Department at MPIA, and I work in the Milky Way group. The focus of the group is the Milky Way, is our home galaxy, and we try to understand how it formed and how it evolved until the structures that we see today. This is important because the Milky Way is the only galaxy where we can really measure the positions, the velocity, and the chemical composition to high mass and low mass stars, young and old stars, all at the same time. This is something that we cannot do for external galaxies. And by studying the Milky Way, we can reach such a level of detail that we can then extend our studies and extrapolate our results to also understand what happened in the history and formation of external galaxies. So the Milky Way is a perfect laboratory to understand how all galaxies in the universe have formed and evolved throughout cosmic history. You might know that the Milky Way has spiral arms. We don't know where the spiral arms are. We don't know how they form, although we have theories, and we don't know what are their properties and how they influence, for example, star formation in the Milky Way. I have been able to trace where spiral arms are, and in the future I plan to use the Sloan Digital Sky Survey data to trace how the stars in the spiral arms move. So you have to imagine that you are in a forest and you're surrounded by trees. It is very hard to understand from the inside of the forest what the structure of the forest is. So my research focuses on exactly on that, trying to understand the structure of the Milky Way, bearing in mind that we are in the Milky Way.
So over the last decades, we, humanity, has learned a lot about how galaxies form. And at MPIA, we've been able to contribute deep and important insights to that process. But we are not done. We don't yet know what dark matter is. We don't yet know what dark energy is. We haven't understood where black holes ultimately come from. But with Euclid, MICADO, surveys like Sloan, and the simulations, we have many more tools to unravel the still open mysteries of galaxy formation.
So there's much more to do, and we're excited about our next research avenues.